Thank you all for coming today. I see lots of familiar faces and some new faces in here. How I'd like to do this is, as I'm going through, if you have questions, please stop me and we can talk about it as we're going through. I just returned back from Haiti last Monday, so what I'll be talking to you about is part of the experience that I had down there. As Nancy said, I've been working down. I actually lived in Haiti in Port-au-Prince for 15 months in 06 and 07, so I have some feel for that. Tim Lindsay, who's up here, and Joe Pickowitz, who didn't get to come today or isn't here yet at least, came down with me and spent a week down there, and I think Joe went down there twice. And the way I like to describe Haiti is when Tim was getting ready to come down to Haiti, he asked me what kind of support they could expect. And I said, well, expect nothing and you won't be disappointed. Well, he was disappointed. He thought he got less. I oversold it. So what I'd like to do today is talk part scientific, but also I want to talk part of the politics. I think it's important that we understand how things got to where they are today and the situation. And obviously, Haiti's been in the news quite a bit. 200 years ago, Haiti was the richest colony in the French Empire, accounted for 40% of Napoleon's income, had a higher GDP than the United States, the original 13 colonies 200 years ago. And today, obviously, we know, we hear about it, we see the pictures, it's the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. And what's sad about it, how many of you have been to the Dominican Republic? Anybody been there? Okay. Well, you can cross the border and you see the difference, but 50 years ago, in 1950, Haiti was actually more prosperous than the Dominican Republic. So this is not something that's happened just overnight. It's something that's can change rather quickly, but with Haiti, it's been a real problem. Anybody know this gentleman here? Who that is? Little test. Well, I think you probably all recognize the skyline of Chicago. DuSable. And who is that? Actually, the credited with being the founder of Chicago. And just to show you how important Haiti was, he was also a Haitian born in St. Mark, Haiti. So a little bit of tie back together. The founder of Chicago is from a small community in Haiti down there. 200 years, things changed rather rapidly. So the talk that I wanted to talk today about was about energy in Haiti. Energy. When I went to Haiti, I went down there to work on a cell phone project, replication of the Grameen Bank Village Phone Program. And if you've heard of Professor Yunus, Nobel Peace Prize in 2006, microloans to women. They get use of a phone and then sell the use of the phone to their friends and neighbors. Well, it turned out the question became, how do you charge a cell phone in a country that has no power grid? And how do you produce power in a country that has no power grid? And the obvious answer is solar in a place that has sun. But solar is expensive. Is there a less expensive way to do that? And as Tim found out, when you go to these communities down there, you'll see each one of the communities in Haiti has a power grid. It turns out that they're in the 70s and 80s, the Duvaliers trying to keep the population under control put in a power grid, and if you follow the lines back, you see this big cat generator, big Caterpillar diesel with a generator on it that powered this grid in the local community. And I thought, well, we'll get the United Nations to fix the generator, and up it'll go, and they'll have power. And then 30 seconds later, the question became, how are they going to power the generator in a community that has no, in a country that has no fossil fuels at all? How are they going to do that? So this is a breakdown of energy usage. In 2005, the Haitian Bureau of Mines and Energy there. As you can see, largest in metric tons was fuel wood. And we'll talk a little bit about what the environment looks like that and what that means for that. But 36% by tons and 9% by value on that. Charcoal, which we all hear about, is only 18%, but the value is $300 per ton. And when you get out into rural Haiti, that's what everybody is doing, is producing charcoal for the major cities. One of the real anomalies of the situation in Haiti is people are very peculiar or very fastidious about their personal dress. The kids that go to school all wear uniforms. The uniforms are pressed. They're starched. They look incredibly clean. But the landscape itself has been totally devastated. It's the personal versus the public is totally separate in people's minds. So the big users of charcoal, which is the big destructive force of the environment, is used for number one for dry cleaning and number two for baking goods in the cities. As you can see, these women are cooking here. And charcoal, little charcoal braziers there. And just a little anomaly with that, that's a solar panel up there. And you'll see the little solar panels all over the power radio and one or two light bulbs going forward. So the question became, how do you develop an economy in a situation like this? Gasoline accounts for 10% of value, $1,050 per ton. And the value on the market, $124,000. Kerosene, mainly for lighting, kerosene lights and lamps. And then finally, diesel. And that is the main source of power, fossil fuel in Haiti today is diesel fuel. And 65% of their transportation dollars are spent on diesel. Diesel is subsidized by the government. They pay $2.99 a gallon for diesel fuel down there, where they pay almost $6 a gallon for gasoline. So diesel is where it's at. And it just so happens that there's an opportunity in this. The last number that I heard was Haiti imported about $400 million of diesel last year. So that's $400 million in theory that could go into the pockets of the growers to begin to change the economy. And by the way, the Haitian economy is based on number one production in the economy is from the million Haitians that live overseas that send money back to Haiti. Mainly, according to President Clinton, 80% of the college graduates from Haiti are in the United States or Canada. Talk about a brain drain. But also, only 1% of the doctors in the U.S. are of African origin, but 13% of that 1% are of Haitian origin. So we are getting the best and brightest from Haiti, and it's not because Haitians want to leave Haiti, it's because there aren't any jobs. And so the question comes back to, again, I keep emphasizing this, how do you create an economy where there isn't an economy? How do you begin to develop an economy where everything is a consumer and nobody is a producer? So let's talk a little bit about the environment. Tim saw a little bit, he's flying over it there. Areas of erosion, these have all been basically, this is a tropical rainforest island that, except for this peninsula right here, was at one time 200 years ago heavily wooded and has now been cut down. We're actually, the area that we've been working on is right up here. This is Faux Liberté, Fort Liberty, right up here, and this is the Dominican border. And yes, if you saw the Al Gore's film or some of the pictures in Jared Diamond's book, Collapse, you saw the pictures of the border between Haiti and the Dominican Republic. Yes, you can actually see that from the air. This is a typical scene, the mountainside. And just to add insult to injury, Haiti is more mountainous as a percent of land than Switzerland. So you've got...
So is
It has been cultivated at one time, and typically they'll plant maize, and they'll get one crop out of it, and then it'll sit there dormant for 10 years, and then they'll burn it again and plant one crop of maize again. And so the land never has, number one, has a chance to recover, and two, trees never have a chance to get big enough to really stabilize the hillsides. So part of the challenge is finding ways to make this land more valuable as a forest than valuable as charcoal. And there's been a number of planting efforts, replanting efforts. Millions of dollars have been spent on that. But typically what happens is they get a consultant coming down from the United States or from France or somewhere like that. The consultant gets paid $100,000 a year, whatever it is, the cost for that. They hire a bunch of people in the village. They plant thousands of trees for 3 years. Everybody has jobs. Everybody's good. The trees are growing great. The contract runs out. The grant runs out after 3 years. The consultant goes on and moves on to another project, and the people are left in the village with no form of income. So 5 years later, the trees are now big enough to make charcoal. The trees get shot down, and the cycle continues again. Because unfortunately, people don't live on 25-year cycles and stuff like that. They eat on three times a day cycle, although most Haitians only eat once or twice a day at maximum. A typical breakfast, our workers, we provide a hot lunch every day for our workers, because that's probably going to be the only meal they're going to get, full meal they're going to get during that time. So they'll come to work on a cup of coffee. Leanne, about 11 o'clock, will fix rice and beans. And if there's a chicken that was too slow or something like that in the yard there, the chicken will end up in the pot also. But people live on very limited diets, but the only people that you see that are overweight are people in Port-au-Prince and stuff like that, or that are working for agencies and stuff like that. The 80% of the farmers, 80% of the Haitians are informally employed, which means they don't have a job, which means every day they get up and try to figure out how they're going to feed themselves and their family. And that's the challenge, and they live right on that edge every day. Are they going to be able to feed their children that particular day? And the big challenge is things like, I talk about Haiti being a consumer country instead of a producer country. 60% of the food that they consume is imported from international. The border crossing between Haiti and the Dominican Republic, it's open on Mondays and Fridays, and it's this tidal wave of food coming across from the Dominican Republic that's sold in Haiti there. Coffee exports dropped 94% between 1984 and 2004. Part of that was competition from Vietnam. Part of it was some agricultural problems. But you can just go down the list of things like that. Haiti used to produce all the rice that they could, they needed to in the country. The U.S. forced them and the World Bank forced them to drop their trade barriers. It was cheaper to import subsidized U.S. rice from Miami than to grow rice in Haiti. So since the 80s, since the trade barriers were dropped, the whole irrigation system that had been built up in the Central Valley was all allowed to deteriorate because people couldn't afford to grow rice. So it's one thing after another, one thing after another, after another. They've created a lot of their problems themselves, but they've also had help from outside. So one of the questions that I would ask you as we go through this, how much of this stuff applies to us? You know, 200 years ago, Haiti was the richest country, and all of a sudden now they're the poorest country. What happened to that? What happened to their jobs? What happened to their productivity and their agriculture and the opportunities? So I ask you to keep that in mind as you think about it for ourselves and our own communities. So let's talk a little bit about this plant right here. This is Monsieur Guomezian, big medicine in Haitian Creole, and it's called Jatropha Kirkus in Latin. And John Scott, right back here with the ISTC, has been nurturing these plants from seeds that somehow got back and all that stuff. But one of the reasons that we're focusing on Jatropha, besides the fact that it's native, I don't want to get any corn farmers unhappy with me, but if you look down this list, you keep going down here, rapeseed, canola oil, which is used for biodiesel in Haiti, or in Europe, excuse me. We've got, in the United States, we've got soybeans that we're using for biodiesel. If you keep coming down the list down here, you find Jatropha down here. Why anybody would use avocados for oil, I have no idea, since that's so good as an avocado, but coconut palms, oil palms are both, but both those require a lot of water. Jatropha, which happens to be native to Haiti, and these are, that's Leanne in the background. Somebody was asking me how old this plant was and how fast it grows. These plants are a couple years old, and they actually grew this big within about 9 months. They grow very fast, and so part of the thing that we're trying to do is, how do you grow this thing? That's one of the reasons I'm here today, is enlist your aid and your support in this. Jatropha is toxic. It has, the reason it's called big medicine, gros médecine, is that there's a toxicity to it. Formyl esters, which, don't ask me what a formyl ester is, but John can tell you if you have questions about that. But it's in voodoo ceremonies in Haiti. It's used to, it's a purgative. It'll clean you right out. Two pills and you're guaranteed that everything will flow, and six pills and you won't feel very good at all with beans like that. But it's been used in Haiti for those types of things, but it's had no other use because of the toxicity. Well, when oil went above about $60 a barrel, which is about the break-even point, that given the yields, given the inputs, those types of things, suddenly Jatropha became very interesting for biodiesel at about $60 a barrel. And I got a lot of heat when oil dipped down after it went to $120 a barrel and then went down to $40 a barrel. I got a lot of heat for saying Jatropha might be a solution for Haiti because it was below $60 a barel, but now it's, what, $84, $85 a barrel today, and I think most everybody in the room will probably agree that there'll be some up and down, but the curve itself is going to continue to go up. So that's why Jatropha, it's an opportunity, it's a native plant. Let's talk about it a little bit. First thing, different from rapeseed or from soybeans, it's a perennial plant, and it's known to the people in Haiti already, so we don't have an issue. We're not bringing in an alien plant. We're not trying to introduce something to society. It's a plant that's already there, and it's a plant that's adapted to it. My approach, as you heard from my background, you'll note I have no agricultural background whatsoever on this. And so this is like 10,000 years ago when rice and wheat and corn, when growers started trying to domesticate those plants, doing that, that's where Jatropha is today. Really, in the 60s, there was some work done by some German researchers in Mali and Africa, but it's only been in the last 10 years that this has really taken off, and as people have looked at the world energy crisis coming forward, India has putting out huge efforts into Jatropha. British Petroleum had a subsidiary that they ended up, that was focused on Jatropha, that they sold off. China is doing this. All across Africa is also looking at Jatropha. But the reason you probably haven't heard much about Jatropha in the United States is it does not like frost. And so it will not grow other than in Dade County in Florida or the south Brownsville, Texas, or the desert in California or something like that. And as we all know, if it doesn't grow in the United States, it probably doesn't exist or something. So, but it's a huge opportunity, but there's been no development going. So there's a whole bunch of issues with this. But the good news is, anybody want to take a guess on oil content on this, these little seeds?
5. Very high.
Very good. Dr. Robin, very good. Thank you. I just got the results in. Here's some Jatropha oil that just got expelled using hexane expelling. And the results that I just heard as I walked in the room, 49% by weight of oil. I did. Would you like to? it actually is, if people are interested, pass that around. It's really got a real nutty hazelnut type smell on it. Sesame oil? Yeah, don't dip your finger in there. There is some toxicity to it. It won't make you sick, by the way, unless you like to lick your finger a lot. The nice thing is it doesn't compete with food. Obviously, in a country like Haiti, where people are going hungry every day, food versus fuel is a real issue. One of the things that the growers in Haiti are real concerned about is, are you going to be growing this in places that you can grow food in? Is this land? And there's a certain segment of the population that says if you can grow anything, you should be growing food. If you'll look at this land, I don't know how well you can see that from there, but this is the land that we're using. This is mesquite that's growing there. The soil is actually pretty good. Because nothing's been growing on it except grass and mesquite for the last 35 years. Prior to that, it was a sisal plantation. If you're familiar with sisal, I had never heard about it, but it was sort of like an aloe vera plant. It's a desert-type plant, and the fibers were used for making rope. And it's the largest sisal plantation in the world in the 40s, and in fact, it was the largest supplier of rope to the U.S. Navy or fibers to the U.S. Navy for ropes during World War II. But obviously, as nylon came on and then old fossil fuel petroleums came on, stuff like that, the need for fiber ropes and stuff decreased. Plantation was shut down in the 70s, which threw literally everybody out of work in the area there. And the field, then some West Texas cattlemen came in, brought West Texas cattlemen that brought mesquite seeds in. And that's how the mesquite got there. And the land is sat dormant or idle. There's free-range cattle and goats running around on that, and that's it. But the good news is, because of that toxicity, the cattle and the goats won't eat the Jatropha. So after the Jatropha is 3 months old, and we've had it field-tested, the cattle have broken down the fence and gotten into the field and field-tested, and they're great at eating the grass, but don't mess with the... Don't drink the one... The doctor says don't drink it there. And the other nice thing is there's low water requirements to this. It's because it's adapted to the native requirements there. So from a standpoint of a plant that you're trying to reach commercial quantities with and at the same time work in the cultural norms, this is pretty good with the... Yes, sir?
How much irrigation, how much water rainfall is there?
Depending... where you're at. And in our area, we're getting about 700 millimeters a year. But it comes, you've got the dry season, and then you've got the rainy season. You've got two seasons. In fact, we get two distinct seasons, two rainy seasons, two dry seasons during the year. The adaptation of the plant, the nice thing about the plant is it will actually shed leaves during the dry season. These plants are like rubber when they really have a lot of water in them. And when the dry season comes along, they will shed all their leaves and basically go dormant until the rain comes. The minute the rain comes, within 3 months, they produce a really healthy stock of leaves. From that, then they begin to flower. The flowers turn into seeds, and the seeds ideally turn into oil, all in a three-month season. So we should be getting two harvests. We've been working with a commercial group over the Dominican Republic that's actually just sort of adopted us. They were driven by and real curious, and the guy is really a neat guy, and it's a Spanish company, and they're actually using drip irrigation. They're getting three harvests a year off the plants, and they have developed a non-toxic seed, and I'll talk about that in a minute. So our big challenge is, how do you do this and do it where you make sense? Where from the seed in the ground, typically the plants, obviously, if there's no commercial value to them, nobody's growing them, so they're just growing wild. How do you take the seeds? How do you get the oil? How do you extract the oil? Can it be used in a stove? And we have a gentleman here that's actually developing a stove for Jatropha seeds here. Transesterification, 10 parts of pure plant oil, 1 part of methanol, and sodium potassium hydroxide as a catalyst, and you get 10 parts biodiesel, and you get 1 part glycerin. So we're also looking at developing soap. And right now, with the cholera epidemic in Haiti right now, hand washing and cleanliness is critical to stopping this epidemic. It's not rocket science how cholera spread or how to stop it. And soap is a key factor, but there isn't any soap in Haiti. The only soap in Haiti is the soap that comes across from the Dominican border. So what about if you can produce soap indigenously there? And obviously glycerin, so we're doing that. And then you saw that big factor on kerosene, the big amount for lighting that was imported in there. So we've also developed some oil lamps use this. So the idea is, how can you develop the whole value chain? So where are we right now? Harvest. Here's Leanne when she's not harvesting or planting. She's fixing lunch for the guys and everybody else. We're an equal opportunity employer, and she's this fabulous mother she's got three little kids. She lives in a little cinder block house that's right by the main road, and she's got a really good life compared to a lot of Haitians like that. They have to be picked by hand because, again, there is no machinery right now that does that, that's been developed for this. This is... Eric is working with Miscanthus, and they're developing the machinery right now to try to develop and harvest and transport Miscanthus. The Indians, where there's a large effort to grow Jatropha, are working on that. The Chinese in southern China, there's a lot of areas of Jatropha, they're working on that. There's some organizations in Africa that are working on that. But right now, one of the advantages that Haiti has is there's a lot of labor available to do this right now. And so our vision is 1,000 growers, each with 3 to 4 hectares apiece. And given nominal yields, that'll produce about 1 million gallons of biodiesel a year. And that, remember when Nancy introduced me, she talked about that cell phone project? Turns out that cell phone company, because there is no power grid, they have generators running 24/7, 365 in every one of their 500-plus cell sites. And so they're having to supply diesel to every one of those cell sites. They've already committed, their chairman of the board has already committed to buying all the biodiesel we can produce. So now all of a sudden it comes back to the value cycle again. It's sold. There is a market for it. We have it, can we really produce it? In 1922, 23, when A.E. Staley opened a plant in Decatur and said, we'll buy all the soybeans you can grow here in Illinois. I think there was something like 5,000 acres of soybeans in 1922 in Illinois. By 1930, there was 500,000. It was this huge magnitude because there was a market created for that. And so what we're trying to do is create the market as we go along, but we have these problems, these technical problems to work out. How do you take it from the laboratory where you get 50% oil using hexane extraction? How do you take that into the real world and make it commercially viable in a country where Tim says, when I told him to expect no support whatsoever, he thought I'd oversold the proposition there. So how do you do that? How do you do that? And that's the challenge of developing a value chain, particularly in a country like that. And that's why the support of the ISTC has been so critical going forward to this day. And I'll show you a couple different places where you guys have been critical in that. Right now, the harvest is totaled by hand. Our big technological step has been these harvest bags that you have the bottom will fall out of it when you bring it in, so you can just drop them out and then start over again like that. That's a big technological step for us. If you look down here, these are seeds that come in a husk, and ideally they're picked right as they're going from the husk actually goes from green to yellow to brown to black. And so ideally you want to catch it just as you're going from yellow to brown, and you can see the differences there. But because there's been no domestication, the fruit on the same bunch, part of the fruit may be green, part may be yellow, and part may be brown, which means multiple passes, which means mechanical harvesting really isn't going to work until you've done the genetic work to actually get the fruit to ripen at a similar time while you're doing that. So we're fortunate to have a plant biologist, a PhD from France, that we're working with, a Haitian, and he's trying to answer some of these questions at the same time. But harvest is a real issue going through there because it's coming, the fruit comes, ripens over a 6 to 8 week period. So it means at least once every other day it's gonna take to do it. I tried harvesting myself when I was down there last week, and this is a 2-hectare field, which is 200 meters by 200 meters, and I was, you know, it was taking me 10 minutes to walk each row to go down there. I've got plants on both sides to walk the row just to do that, and you begin to look at the time it'll take to do that. So there's a significant investment in this, really bringing this to market. Seed preparation, we're finding out, and oil extraction. Right now we're using mechanical extraction, which means any dirt, anything like that that we get into the expeller. I'll show you a picture in a minute, but it's basically just a, yes. The chairman of the board said we'll buy it at quality bio, if you can produce a reliable supply of quality biodiesel at competitive prices, we'll buy it. So we're going to have to meet the petroleum market price to do that. But we can do that. And the growers can still make some money on this going forward with this. And we're counting on oil going up. Yeah, because sure.
Can you not run the generators on the oil itself instead of converting it into biodiesel?
Some generators you can, some you can't. I mean, we haven't even, it's Caterpillar, and some of the diesel manufacturers won't even allow biodiesel more than 20% in their engines. And still maintain their warranty. The testing that Tim's group's done and stuff like that, and maybe you can answer that better than I can.
I think that if you preheat it,
But using the pure plant oil, we're not advocating that right now, just from the standpoint of Haiti, the problems with biodiesel is in temperature. mainly, and Haiti doesn't get cold enough that there's a problem with temperature. You're just using the pure plant oil depends on the actual contents of the Jatropha oil and the engine itself. Lister diesel engines supposedly run great on pure plant oil. But most of the engines that, like Digicel, are using are Caterpillar. They're the top of the line engines and stuff like that, generators.
The capital tied up in the existing infrastructure cannot handle the pure oil.
Exactly. Exactly.
I think it can if you preheat it, though, for sure. I mean, the only reason you really convert it to biodiesel is to reduce the viscosity, and you can reduce the viscosity by heating.
Well, and see, this is why we need your help, like that. This is why I'm here today.
It's not convenient to preheat it on a vehicle, and that's why people convert to biodiesel for a vehicle.
Right.
The generator would be different.
The transesterification process, or the oil extraction process, has become our real stumbling block right now. We're having real problems with that, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Transesterification, the guys down there have really gotten that process down thanks to Tim and Joe that went down there and trained them. They can produce biodiesel, quality biodiesel. You guys have checked it and all that stuff, and it comes out and meets ASTM standards. So that's not an issue going forward with that. The glycerin, as I talked about, we're actually making soap right now. And you probably, if you look over here, there's a little white thing on the tree here. I don't know whether you can see it. That's a glycerin soap dispenser there. We're going with liquid soap and as opposed to bar soap. Haitians seem to like we did some test marketing, and they seem to like liquid soap a lot better. And so we've got these dispensers. The dispensers are free. You have to buy the soap, and we're trying to get them into the clinics, the health clinics, and those types of things around in the Northeast just for that reason. Obviously, honey, Jatropha is a plant that flowers. Flowers need to be pollinated. We can produce more seeds if they're pollinated more, and so we have beehives around there, lamp stoves. Now here's the two most interesting things, the parts of it right now. The seed cake, which is after you've squeezed the seed and you've got that 50% of oil by weight out of that seed, what remains is what's called seed cake. And that seed cake has more nitrogen than chicken manure. So it's an organic, green organic fertilizer can be used to go back into the fields, which is what we're encouraging the farmers to do, to use that, or it can be used for other growing other crops. It also, and the interesting part about this that makes it really interesting and makes the developmental work so important, is it has more protein than soybeans in it. It has a larger content, the seed cake, than soybeans. So immediately, we begin to think of animal feed. Well, that's the issue right now. The toxicity is in there. This 4-bol ester is in there, so it cannot be used for animal feed. But if the toxicity can, number one, be grown out of the seeds, genetically modified, or however it would come about, where you would have seeds that didn't have this toxicity in it, or during the extraction process, the 4-bol esters could be removed. Then you have an animal feed that has more protein than soybeans in it, and you suddenly have a source of feed for swine, for poultry, and for tilapia. Those three things. So this is the challenge, this whole developmental challenge that we're trying to address, is how do you put together this value chain? How do you take this and put it into actual commercial production? The reason the sheep are here is that obviously we've got fields, animals won't eat the plant, but we're growing plenty of grass now. The grass is actually greener inside the fence rather than outside the fence because of the trees are providing shade and a windbreak for the moisture retention. And so the grass is growing much better. Rather than cut the grass so it doesn't compete with the animals, we're just turning the animals loose in there. Ideally, we would be raising goats, which is the most popular food in Haiti because it really takes care of itself. But goats also climb out of anything and get loose everywhere and all that stuff. Sheep are pretty dumb, and so that we can keep sheep corralled and everything like that, and so we're doing sheep. We took the easy way out on that one.
Question back on, you mentioned again the advantages of that being other advantages of that. Some of them may even be that bugs and insects may not bother the pesticides. So now if you breed that out, you open up a whole other set of problems. Are they looking at breeding the toxicity out of the seed and leaving it in the plant?
I'm glad you asked that question. This Spanish company that's doing work in the Dominican Republic is actually claims that they have done that. And so we are actually in the process of trying to get enough seeds so we can test that. We, ISTC, can test that and see, in fact, whether that's true. We literally just got... We bought a couple kilos of seeds from them, and we'll be starting our own nursery of non-toxic varietals just to test that type of thing. Because I didn't have an agricultural background, my idea was to import seeds from India to start this out. The partner, the co-founder of this, is a landscape architect from the University of Georgia in Athens, Georgia, Rob Fisher, and we have two Haitian Ministry of Agriculture agronomists, I love that word, that were working with us. One was trained at the University of Florida and the other one Texas A&M. So they're brilliant men that chose to go back to Haiti and try to make a better country for themselves and their families. But they suggested, because of the agricultural diversity, because of the adaptation, that we collect local seeds, and that's where we got our seed stock to begin with. We actually put out the call that Digicel was, because there's no way to charge cell phones, they were selling hand crank chargers where you could charge your phone just cranking. And I got 100 of those donated, and we put out the word that bring us two coffee cans full of Jatropha seeds and you'll get a crank charger. And so we got more seeds than we knew what to do with. They came from everywhere. We had no idea what they were or anything like that. So now each generation, we've been trying to select the best plants from that and then for our next generation, use the best seeds from the seeds before like that. It's very unscientific, and I'm not an agronomist, so I'm not the right one to answer questions about that, but that's the natural selection, and the fact that they're already adapted locally is exactly what we've been trying to do. Because of the toxicity, Jatropha does not seem to have many natural enemies. We're not having any infestation insect problems. My cursory view of the field type thing, the plants were robust and healthy and everything. So, but that could certainly be a problem going on. Just a couple of the challenges that we're trying to work on. The plant variations, as I said, the ripening of the seeds when they ripen is a real challenge in the harvest standpoint because it's spread out over a two-month period. When do you harvest them, how, and you have to do the repeated pass-throughs to the field to get those at the correct time. The toxicity, the good news, bad news about that. The whole idea of the transportation right now, how do you get the fertilizer back to the farmer after you've taken the oil out of it? How does that do it? This is the rose down mini 40 that used to live here at the University of Illinois, and then Tim and Joe and I actually found it in a warehouse in Seymour or somewhere in Seymour, Illinois, that it was surplus by the university and put out to pasture, and sat in a warehouse covered with plastic for 15 years, and now it's down in Haiti. If anybody needs any instructions on how to assemble or disassemble a rose down mini 40 expeller, I am now an expert at it. I get in there with the guys here, and the three of us have become chief expeller assemblers, disassemblers. We had broken O-rings. We've done everything with it. Last time I came down there, and all of a sudden when the gearbox started leaking oil, and I realized that they'd broken the wheels off too, off the frame, and so it was like at a level like this, and so once we leveled it, it didn't start leaking anymore, and a few things like that. But those have been the challenges that we're trying to do. The animal feed, where we'll go with that, stand by. Get me an 18 months from now, and I can give you an update on what it looks like as far as if, in fact, the non-toxic varietals are going to work, and we can begin using this for tilapia, swine, and poultry. But one of the real challenges is, how do you know whether the farmers mix toxic seeds into non-toxic seeds when they bring there to that? So we're going to have to develop a simple, inexpensive test that can be done on the seeds when it's brought in to ensure that we're not getting toxic material into the animal food chain. Or it'll ruin the market pretty quickly like that, really quickly. When you kill somebody's chickens, they're not going to be real happy with that. And finally, the last thing I wanted to talk about with the value chain here was the Haitian political and business climate. I kid Tim about, you know, he got less than no support when he came down there. And the example we use is, he said, "Did we have water for the transesterification project?" "Oh yeah, we've got water. We've got a pond there with a pipe and a pump that broads it up, but the pond goes dry in the summer, so we have a hand-dug well. The two guys, two brothers, one guy goes down the hole, the other guy stays up there, and they dug it down to about 10 meters down there. But no problem. We have, and it started to go dry, so we have now 50-meter well, you know, about 160 feet. No problem, we'll have water all the time with that. "Do you have a pump?" "Oh yeah, we have a pump." Well, you get down there and there's a minor detail with the pump. It's a surface pump, not a submersible pump. So we get a submersible pump after we find out that one in the Dominican Republic costs three times as much as it would have cost in the States, and we actually found one in Cap-Haitien that was two times as much. And we come back out and Joe wires it all up, and of course, so we've got a 150-foot well, so we put 80-foot pipe on it, 80 feet of pipe, and then we have a 10-foot extension where the intake nozzle goes in and the pump, and so we've got 90 feet of pipe. And it's Thursday night, we're leaving Friday, it's starting to get dark, but it's about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We'll put it down the well, get it going, everything will be fine. We put it down the hole, and all of a sudden we have about 20 feet sticking up in the air, and it's stuck. Of course, it's stuck, and then in the Haitian way if it's stuck, you bang it harder. And so we bang it harder, and of course nothing happens. So I pull it out, look at it, nothing's caught on it. So put it back down, bang it some more, doesn't do that, and pull it back out. Why don't we lower something down and see how deep the hole really is? So we lower a rope down with a hole, and the hole is only about 80 feet deep, so hence our 90 feet of pipe is hitting the bottom with things sticking up in the air. So we cut off the pipe and start to put it back down again. We get it back down there. We wire it up to the pump there and wire the pump to the generator. Throw the generator on. Water comes flowing out 15 seconds, and then all of a sudden the circuit breaker pops. Well, must be the circuit breaker. Try it again, pops. Do it, try it again, pops. By now it's pitch dark, it's raining. So we go back. The next morning, Tim and Joe and Rob get up at 4 a.m. in the morning, go back out there. They determine that it's the generator has gone bad on it, and the generator's gone bad. So we leave, all that stuff. They call out the Haitians call out the Haitian electrician. The guy pulls it out. The wires had come loose on the pump from all the banging. The generator's fine. But that's the type of thing that you're dealing with. In the United States, we expect when you have a machine, you plug it into the wall and the electricity comes on and away you go. And it takes, 20 seconds to find the cord to plug it in, to flip the switch, and you're off and running. this took 4 days to even get water into the situation like that, not to mention power and stuff like that. That's the challenge of doing business in Haiti, but that's also the opportunity. How do you begin to turn this around? And my belief is that as you begin to develop this value chain, this $400 million that's going right now to the oil barons in the U.S. and to Venezuela can go into the growers' pockets in rural Haiti. And for me, that's how you do economic development. Thank you very much for your time, and I'll take any questions. Yeah, John.
Cell phones seem to be a big deal there. Do you have an idea of how much of a person's annual income it takes to own and support a phone? And the second question is, in terms of competing with oil, will Jatropha have a transportation advantage if it's more local and doesn't have to be trucked in over the mountain or something of that nature?
First question, cell phones, there were two cell phone companies that started in Haiti in the mid-90s down there. And by 2006, they had between them 700,000 customers. Digicel, this Irish cell phone company, started up in the summer of 2006, and within 18 months, they had 2.1 million customers. They used a different business model than the two original cell phone companies were using, a U.S. business model. Digicel was using a European one. And to be fair, though, the price of cell phones went down. But prior to Digicel's arrival, the cheapest cell phone was $100. Once Digicel got there, they started selling them at cost, $20. Annual income is around $500. So you can do the math, 4%, a little over 4% of their annual income. Now, to say that, there's a difference between having a cell phone and using it. Because another part of the model is Haitians only pay for outgoing calls. If I call you in the States, you pay, I pay, we both pay. In Europe and Haiti, you only pay for outgoing calls, you don't pay for incoming. So Haitians have cell phones, but they may not have any time on them, which means they can't call out, but they can receive calls. So relatives in the States will give them a phone, and so they can call them, but they can receive calls, but they can't get it. third thing is charged phones. Having a cell phone is a status symbol, and every place there's power. Every time we turned on the generator at the Pepinye, everybody would rush over and plug their cell phones into the outlets so they could get their cell phone charged at that time. You go to any place that has a generator, most churches and stuff like that, they will do that. As far as transportation goes, the answer is I certainly hope so. That the model we're hoping to use is a cooperative model for the actual production of the biodiesel itself. I started out talking about Grameen Phone and Professor Yunus. Grameen Phone is actually it's the largest cell phone company in Bangladesh right now, but it's 51% owned by Norwegian Telecom, Telnor, and 49% owned by the Grameen Bank. The model we're using is the same type of thing. Have a professional organization run the biodiesel plant, but have the growers own that 49%, the minority share, so they have a stake in that. Because this whole issue of security, protecting where rule of law is a little shaky sometimes, it's really important that the people in the community feel like it's part of them, that they have a stake in it, as opposed to it's some blonde woman from Illinois or something like that that owns it. Does that answer your question? Any other?
So who runs your day-to-day operation?
George Rondel, who's a Haitian agronome, agronomist. He's our manager down there. And he's well-trained in agronomy. And that's what he's doing right now. He's been with us for 3 years. We have a team of six people that have been with us for 3 years now, and then we hire people when we're doing planting. We're planting 1,650 plants per hectare, 2 meters by 3 meters spacing. And so hand planting, you can imagine planting 1,650. Eric knows about planting rhizomes for miscanthus and how much that takes and stuff like that. So that's been our challenge going forward, is that type of thing. The biggest challenge has been land preparation. The soil is real heavy. It hasn't been disturbed in almost 30 years. And the mesquite, we haven't had a tractor, so we've been having to dig out the mesquite stumps by hand. And we've been spending over $1,000 per hectare to prepare the land. We just have a tractor. We got donations for a tractor, and the tractor should be arriving in January. And the goal is to drop our field preparation cost to under $400 a hectare. Any other? Yeah.
Land availability. Who actually owns the land?
Much of the land in Haiti is owned by the government. Haitians, they have an informal system that I'm told is sort of like the French system. If you live on it and work it, it's yours. And because most of the land, Haiti, like most countries, a big percentage of the population is moving off the land and into the major cities. When I drove through, because of the disturbances when I was down there in Haiti the last week, I had to drive rather than fly. Actually, the disturbance was at the airport in Cap Haitien, so I couldn't fly into it. They closed the airport. So I drove both ways, and much of the land is just deserted. Much of the land is like that picture on the hillsides there. Beautiful rolling plains on the central plateau there that I think could be very fertile. I mean, the land is much more fertile, and they get much more water than 700 millimeters in that area.
One farmer can work 4 hectares, you said, more or less.
Right.
He and his family in the same.
Right.
Okay, so the land's there, and nobody's on it because there's nothing valuable on it.
Exactly.
But as soon as he works it, 3 years into it, now all of a sudden it's worse than it. Are you thinking ahead to where a mechanism to where he's actually got title to it, so it's his,
Because we're working with the particular land that we're working on has all been designated for farmer groups, co-op groups, and within their co-op group, they're dividing up the land in between it. But they have paperwork to the land, not to own, but to use the land in perpetuity from the government. It's a risk. That's one of the reasons that I'm trying to stay very close to this Irish cell phone company, Digicel, is they happen to be the largest taxpayer and the largest employer in Haiti. And if anybody can influence things, it's them from a political standpoint. But it's a risk. But they've shown that you can run a high-tech company very successfully in a country like Haiti, in spite of getting no support at all, less than no support at all. Anything else? Well, thank you very much for your time, and keep warm.